of triumph. Good morning, church. We are very glad to be here this morning. And as I began by saying, clap unto God. Clap unto God. He is a good God. God has been good to all of us. And we can testify to that fact. He is a faithful God. There is no one like him. Shall we stand as we begin this morning's service? Let's all bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks this morning, God, because you are a great God. Father, you are majestic. You are merciful. You are magnificent. There is no God like you. Father, you are the omnipotent one, the omnipresent one. Heavenly Father, the omniscient one. You know everything there is to know about us, Father. And this morning, God, we are here in your sanctuary, Father, to give you praise and to glorify your name, God, because you are God alone and because you deserve it. Father, we thank you for the goodness that you have extended to us. Blessings, God, both great and small. Heavenly Father, today we want to declare our love for you, Father. And so we've come to worship you in the beauty of holiness. Father, we pray this morning, God, that even as we lift up our voices, and Heavenly Father, and as we bow our hearts in reverence to you, God, Father, that you'll be satisfied, God. You'll be pleased with the sacrifices of our praise this morning. Father, we want to say to you, God, this morning that we adore you. Father, for there is no one who deserves our praise, God, but you. And so, Father, this morning we want to ask your blessings upon our worship team, upon the speaker, upon the musicians, God, upon everyone who should take a part in this service this morning. And Father, today, Lord God, we come against every plan of the enemy for this service. Father, every plan of disruption, God, we come against it right now in the name of Jesus. And Father, we are asking this morning, God, that you take preeminence, oh God, in this place. Father, for you, oh God, are worthy. Father, we bless you and we say thank you, God, for all that you will do today in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, I'm going to invite Brother and Sister Robinson, who will do the scripture reading for us.
Blessed good morning to the church. Good morning. The scripture lesson will be taken from St. John chapter 15, reading from verse 1 to 17. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Here beginning. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener.
He cuts out every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he pruneth, so that it will be even more fruitful.
You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you.
Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me.
I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me, and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing.
If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned.
If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given to you.
This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples.
As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love.
If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love.
I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete.
My command is this, Love each other as I have loved you.
Greater love has no man than this, that he laid down his life for his friends.
You are my friends if you do what I command.
I no longer call you servant, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friend. For everything that I learned from my father, I have made known to you.
You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name.
This is my command. Love each other.
Here
ends
the reading.
A blessed good morning to the church. What a privilege to be gathered in the house of the Lord yet another Sunday morning. Stand with me as we go before God's throne in worship. Now, this month is celebrated as African Awareness Month, but to me it is all about speaking about freedom, the freedom that has been graced upon us by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, because without him we would still be in bondage, not necessarily the bondage that our ancestors were in as slaves, but the bondage of sin. So this morning, I come to declare that we are free, and to demonstrate what freedom those of you who have not yet accepted God as your personal Lord and Savior can find in him. Amen.
I'm
which we are going to do. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock.
All my fears are gone.
I declare that perfectly.
Oh, God is indeed an awesome God this morning. And I just want to share with you his love, his everlasting love, love that we cannot comprehend. Even when our friends and parents and anyone who loves us, God loves us unconditionally. And this morning I want to tell you about his amazing love. And no one knew how alone I was feeling, and the emptiness I tried so hard to hide. Though I left and said my life was fine without you, I was covering up the secret tears inside. And then one day, someone told me of your mercy and the love you showed on a hill called Calvary. But there you died and purchased my redemption.
I stand amazed in the presence of the Lord as we enjoy enjoy the love that he has for us. And if you are enjoying that love this morning, give God a clap offering, because he is indeed a God to God, a God who loves us with every core of his being. He is a God that loves us. Hallelujah. Good morning to the church. Good morning, brothers and sisters. And I pray that you are well this morning. I pray that you are enjoying the presence, that beautiful, that wonderful presence of our Lord Savior. Hallelujah. Almighty Father, we give you praise this morning. We give you thanks for your goodness and your mercy. We give you thanks for your love, Lord. We thank you that you're a God who says that you will love us forever. Father, you told Jeremiah you love him with an everlasting love. And you have that same love for us today. Father, I pray even as the word goes that you will remove self even now in the name of Jesus. And Father, as the word goes to your people, dear Lord, Father, dear Lord, I pray that they will not only be hearers, but they will be doers of the word, dear Lord. That they will go into their hearts, Father, dear Lord. And they, Father, they will use the word, dear Lord, to benefit you, to benefit your kingdom. Father, I pray this in no other name but the precious name of Jesus. Hallelujah. If you are indeed happy to be here, give God a clap offering again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This morning I call your attention to the text found in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And I will be reading from the New King James Version. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and understand all mysteries and knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. Is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in the mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. I want to repeat that again. And now abideth faith, hope, love. These things, but the greatest of these is love. And I chose this scripture because, yes, our sister spoke of freedom. And this month is the African, they address the African wear, celebrate freedom. But in this month, we also celebrate love. And the two goes in hand. Because of God's love, we are free. Hallelujah. This morning I present to you my sermon title, The Greatest Gift. Some may say the greatest gift is life. Others may say time. Tangibly speaking, we all love it. We all love receiving gifts. Gifts are for every occasion. Birthdays, weddings, Christmas, Valentine, anniversary. And I could go on for a whole lot of them. Because nowadays, for every occasion, it's a gift occasion. But as young children growing up, we look forward with certain anticipation to our birthdays and Christmas, with expectations of receiving a gift, especially at Christmas, when we would receive great gifts from dear friends and loved ones. I don't know about you, but I also love giving gifts and seeing the joy on the faces of those receiving them. Indeed, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Acts 20:35 tells us that. Brothers and sisters, by giving, God demonstrated his love towards us. Permit me to share an experience with you. Last year, around November or so, my six-year-old cousin was calling around, reminding family members of his birthday, and inquiring what they will be giving him. When he called my mother, she told him, I will give you the love of God. His response was, you've got to be kidding me. You serious? My six-year-old cousin did not understand what he was being offered. But this morning, I offer you this same gift, the greatest gift of all, the gift of love. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, love is the greatest gift one can give. And it is the greatest gift one can receive. As living beings, we desire to show our love. And we also desire to receive love. Our scripture today says, without love, we are nothing. Many have asked the question, what's love got to do with it? They have even sang the song, what's love got to do with it? Remember Tina Turner? She had a song named, What's Love Got to Do with It? I'm sure us older folks can remember that one. But brothers and sisters, I submit to you today, love has everything to do with it. I'm going to repeat that again for you. Love has everything to do with it. Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 to 39 tells us, you shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. The act of love in its purest form, as Paul so eloquently writes it, is a love which is of great importance. It reminds us of God's love for us, and it also reminds us of the love we must share with others, the agape love of God. What is the agape love? It is the love of 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It is the love of Genesis chapter 1. It is the love of Revelations chapter 22, verse 21. A love which never fails. As believers, nothing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which we have found in Christ Jesus. And we can find that in Romans chapter 8. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing we do. No, we can go down to the pits. We can fly high. We can go wherever. We will still have that love of God. Hallelujah. It is the love of God which we have found in Christ Jesus that the Apostle Paul speaks of as he addresses the church at Corinth. And it is the love we will focus on in the next few moments. Here in our scripture, the Apostle Paul is reminding the Corinthians that they are nothing and that their gifts were useless without love. And unwrapping the greatest gift before them, Paul reveals love in three main points. These points will guide our sermon today. These points are, one, the core of love. Two, the character of love. And three, the continuity of love. But I want to go back a little bit about the Corinthians. In taking a look at Corinth, one would see it was a very immoral city. In fact, their reputation was so bad that there was a Greek word that meant to live immorally like a Corinthian. Such immoral living was perhaps one of the reasons why Paul traveled there to offer them hope towards a new reality and a new way of living and believing. But it wasn't long before immorality found its way in the congregation. The church had divided loyalty among them. They were tolerating immoral living. There was confusion about marriage. And given the mixed culture of the church, comprising of both Jews and Greeks, many doctrinal divisions arose. So when Paul heard of the problems they were facing, he quickly responded with the message of love. It is from that message that we find our first point, the core of love. The core of love is exemplified in 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 to 8. And it says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love." Love is the central and the most important part of a Christian life. Love is what we do with our passion and our compassion. And when we speak about passion and compassion, the story of the Good Samaritan comes to mind. He didn't have to do it, but because of his compassion, because of his passion, he did it. He saved a man he didn't even know. He not only saved him, he took him to an inn and he paid for him, expecting nothing in return. Brothers and sisters, do we have that love this morning? Do we have that compassion? Do we have that passion for our fellow human beings? God expects us to have, as Christians, God expects us to have that passion and that compassion. Hallelujah. Verse 1 to 3 of our scripture speaks of the core of love, the superiority of love. We understand that love is most important compared to anything else, and that love is superior to all spiritual gifts. Now, we can imagine that on that road that the thieves or the robbers tried to kill this man, it wasn't only the Samaritan, it was a priest and Levite. And we could only think in our minds that they were blessed with spiritual gifts. But did they use them to benefit God? Did they use them to benefit God, or did they use it to benefit themselves? In my reading and my understanding, they did not use them to benefit God. Because if they were using them to benefit God, they would have helped that man on the road. In fact, I believe that they used them just to benefit themselves on that occasion. The Corinthians were spiritually gifted with the gift of knowledge, the gift of faith, the gift of generosity, and particularly the gift of tongues. and sisters, the Corinthians, allow these gifts to overshadow the gift of love. We too are sometimes guilty of this. Instead of showing love, we tend to lord over with gifts that God has given us. Our gifts are to glorify God, not ourselves. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10 to 13 says, as each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If anyone minister, let him do it as if with the ability which God supplies, that in all things God may be glorified through Christ Jesus, to whom belong the glory and the dominion forever and ever. The gifts that God has given us are not to glorify us, but they are to glorify God. There's a scripture that says, let our light so shine that others may see and glorify God who is in heaven. We must use the gifts that God has given us to glorify God. Brothers and sisters, the Corinthians were not using these gifts out of love, but of their own selfish gain. The core of love speaks of selfless love, sacrificial love, and sincere love. A love not only for our ears, but a love for our eyes also. John 3:16 tells us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. He not only told us, he showed us, and he's shown us even today. When we think of selfless love, we think of God giving his only Son to be a sacrificial lamb for us. And when we think of Jesus being that sacrificial lamb, willingly going to the cross so that you and I can become heirs and joint heirs with him, that is love. That is love. Such love. Such wondrous love. And this songwriter is a hymn that we sing. Such love. Such wondrous love that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful. Hallelujah. How wonderful is his love for us. Hallelujah. Such love. And furthermore, John chapter 15, I think we heard it this morning, verse 13 says, greater love has no man than this, that he laid down his life for his friend. Sincere love? Can we call that sincere love?
Yes.
God is love. Hallelujah. Without love, brothers and sisters, we would not be here. Without love, we are nothing. Brothers and sisters, let love be your guiding principle. Amen. Tongues are good. Prophecy and knowledge and faith, they are good also. Sacrifice is good. But love is valuable. So vital. So valuable. That apart from it, every other good thing is useless. Hallelujah. The love of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Secondly, brothers and sisters, I want to bring your attention to the character of love. Love suffers long. Love will endure a long time. It is the heart shown in God when it is said of the Lord, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some call slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. Brethren, if God's love is in us, we will show long suffering. We will be patient and not complain when faced with negativity from others. When the road gets rough, we will not quit. When things are not going our way, we will not give up. We will suffer long. When it gets rough, you know, like if you're on the sea, well, I have never, I have been on the cruise, but not a cruise with those big ships. But you go, oh, I don't know if you feel those waves.
Yes.
Getting rough. Mm-hmm. And you may get a little bit scared. But you know what? You want to enjoy the cruise. So what you do? You suffer long. You suffer long. You suffer long because we know what is to come. Hallelujah. The Apostle Paul can identify with this long suffering. After his conversion, during his ministry, he experienced much tribulation. The Jews did not want anything to do with him. He was beaten. He was stoned. He was shipwrecked, arrested. Despite all of what he went through, his love for God and for man remained steadfast. Long suffering. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, love is also kind. When we have and show God's love, it will be seen in the simple acts of kindness. Have you been kind to someone lately? Now, we always talk about love. And we talk about, I love you. We can say in many languages, it means the same thing. And it's easy to say. But what is most important is when we show it.
That's
right. When we show it in acts of kindness.
Amen.
And that's what God wants us to be kind. Kind to each other. So then we may think in ourselves they don't deserve it. But everyone deserves kindness.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, love bears all things. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8 tells us, and above all things, have fervent love for one another. For love will cover a multitude of sin. And we're not going to that. We know what that means. Love believes all things. To believe all things means that we give others the benefit of the doubt. It means that we expect the best. It means that we are able to overlook the offenses and failures of others. Believing all things means that we are willing to trust one another. Love hopes all things. Love has confidence in the future. Things may not look too good today. Things may not look too good right now where you're standing. But you know what? Tomorrow it will be better.
Amen.
Right now we are in a COVID situation, but tomorrow it will be better. Because our God sees everything. And we sing again we sing a chorus, things already better. Hey, I love that chorus. Things already better. Things are already better, sisters and brothers. You know why? Because we have God on our side. Because we have God, a God who loves us, a God who is love himself. It hopes in the best and it hopes in God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Love endures all things. To endure is to bear up under pressure, to bear up courageously, to remain patient in the midst of opposition. Brothers and sisters, the story of Job comes to mind. His steadfast love for God remained in spite of what he went through. And we know the things that Job went through. His children, they died all one time. His livestock destroyed. His servants, they too died. Job was even afflicted with horrible skin sores. And you know what? Even though Job is going through all this, his wife, she didn't even want to support him. This is what she said to him. Curse God and die. If your own wife, your own spouse can tell you that, after all that you're going through, curse God and die. But you know what? Job refused. Oh yeah, don't talk. His friends, they accused him of probably doing something wrong. They were not true friends. They too had given up. He was under a lot of pressure. But Job refused to listen to the negativity around him. And he remained faithful, faithful to God. That's how God wants us to be. Despite whatever we are going through, despite whatever, whoever is talking in our ears, the negativity, God wants us to remain steadfast, to endure. Because it says, weeping may endure for the night, but joy, hallelujah, joy comes in the morning. God's love will allow us and strengthen us to endure. God's love for us and our love for God will give us strength to endure. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, the character of love also speaks to what love is not. Love does not envy. Envy accomplishes nothing except hurt. Envy enslaved Joseph. Envy murdered Abel. Envy put Jesus on the cross. Matthew 27, 18 tells us, for he knew that they had handed him over because of envy. Brothers and sisters, this morning, do not let envy overtake us. Because love is not envy. Love cannot function where there's envy. Because where there's envy, there's hatred. And that's the complete opposite of love. Love does not parade itself. Does not have the limelight. It do not even want the limelight. Or the attention to do a good job. It doesn't need it. It doesn't parade itself. If we're going to do something, we're doing it for the glory of God. We're doing it for God. We don't have to be up front and in everybody's face. We can do it behind the scenes for God. We can do it in the closet for God. It does not parade itself. Love gives because it loves to give. Not out of a sense of praise it can have for showing itself off. Love is not puffed up, not arrogant or self-focused. It does not allow pride to get in the way. Love does not behave rudely. Brothers and sisters, we should have respect for each other. We should have respect for ourselves. When we do not have respect, we behave rudely. Love does not seek its own. Philippians chapter 2 verse 4 tells us, let each of you look out not only for your own interests, but also for the interests of others. Are we doing that today? Do we have a cupboard full of groceries and our brothers and sisters are coming in every day saying, oh, but I have nothing to feed the children. But you got these groceries, right? And you can't even say, well, let me bring a bag and give you. All you're thinking is that, well, the more you got, the better for me because it'll last me longer. Is that what God expects of us? No, love does not seek itself. You know, we have some old people that say, but I will give the last say of God. They still have persons like that. They will give you the last of what they have. That is what God expects of us. When he says it does not seek its own, he expects us to give when we have and not try to hold on to everything for ourselves. Do not think of the other person. We have to think of our brothers and sisters, especially in this time. Love is not provoked. When we allow ourselves to be provoked, we sin against God. Colossians chapter 3, verse 21 says, "Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged." We're not only sinning against God, we discourage our children. We discourage our friends when we are easily provoked. We discourage. We provoke them and we discourage them. This morning I pray that instead we will be encouraging. We will be encouraging each other. Despite what may be going on with us or around us in our homes and our workplace. That we will allow the words of other persons or the actions of other persons to provoke us into sinning. But instead, we will always have an encouraging word for each other.
Amen.
Love thinks no evil. In other words, love does not store up the memory of any wrong it has received. In other words, again, in Beijing term, don't hold the body in your mind. Don't hold a soul in your mind. Let the past be in the past. Now, if we hold people in mind and we store all these things that we think, all the wrongs we think they have done to us, we won't have any space in these little minds of ours for love. We won't have any space in this little mind of ours for generosity, for forgiveness, for caring, for kindness. We cannot store up any wrongdoings that we have received. Don't hold the body in your mind. If nothing else you leave today, don't hold the body in your mind. The only thing we should hold in our mind today is love. Love does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoice in truth. It is willing to want the best for others. Brothers and sisters, let us love as God loves us. Finally, let us look at the continuity of love. Love never fails. God's love for us is everlasting. And I can smile at that because I know it. And even when he told Jeremiah, "I have loved you with an everlasting love." Brothers and sisters, that same love that he had for Jeremiah, he had for us today.
Amen.
Do you feel loved this morning?
Amen.
Do you feel loved by God this morning?
Amen.
Oh, but I get goosebumps when I think about the love of God
Amen.
Towards me.
Yeah.
And I pray that you too are having them. When you think about God's glorious love, his wonderful love, a love that will never leave us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God's love is everlasting. Everlasting means forever and forever. So much so that Romans 8:35-39 gives us the joy of knowing that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Brothers and sisters, I believe Paul is saying that when Jesus makes his return, we will no longer have needs for these spiritual gifts, and that they will vanish away, but love will continue. This love will also be revealed to us. Verse 12 of our text tells us, "For now we see in the mirror dimly, but then face to face, Jesus will reveal face to face. 1 John chapter 3 verse 2 says, "Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." Hallelujah. Brethren, is that not a glorious thing to expect? Amen. Isn't that a glorious expectation to see him as he is? Brethren, there will be no more barriers to our relationship with God. We will have perfect fellowship with God. And we believe this to be true because we know that love conquers all. Again, I want to mention Joseph. After all the terrible things his brothers did to him, years later, when he encountered them, he showed his love for them by forgiving them. Love is greater than anything else. There is no fear in love. This love I am speaking of allows us to overcome and to conquer. Joseph overcame and he conquered. He went from pit to palace. The enemy, God did not allow the enemy to destroy him in the prison, but instead to lift him up. And we know that our God is still the same God. He is still the same God yesterday, today, and forever. He cannot change. He will not change. He will love us forever. And Romans 8:28 tells us, all things work for the good of those who love the Lord. So brothers and sisters, know that you are blessed. Know that things will work out on your behalf. Know that things will only get better because you love the Lord. And he loved you so much that he would make things better. We did not love him first. We are not the first. God loved us first. And that is how we know how to love, because of his love for us. Hallelujah. I conclude in the manner in which I began. Love is the greatest gift. This love gives us the opportunity to meet Jesus face to face. Beloved, when this happens, it becomes the greatest of the three Paul speaks of. For hope and faith would have fulfilled their purpose. We won't need faith when we see God face to face. We won't need hope in the coming of Jesus once he comes. But we will always need love. Loving the Lord and each other. And I encourage you that while we await his coming, let us be good examples and being what is the core of love. Let us reflect the character of love. And let us believe in the continuity of love. Brothers and sisters, we are expecting many things this year. Our theme is a year of great expectancy. And I pray that you will expect to live a life of love, expecting love and expecting to give love, expecting to receive love and expecting to give love, because God is love. And when we love God, all things, not some things, but all things work on our behalf. Please stand with me. this morning, I encourage you that if you are expecting God's love, expect to give God's love also, because that is what he is expecting of us. Don't think that we should be the only ones receiving it. Don't think that you are the only body that should say, oh, God loved me and that's it. If you do not share God's love, what's the purpose in having it? What is the purpose of having God's love if you do not share it? So this morning, I encourage you to share it, not only in words, not only in words, but in action. Not only for our ears, but for our eyes. May God continue to bless you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I give you praise this morning. Father, I thank you for your glorious love, your wonderful love, your everlasting love, your eternal love, your sacrificial love, your sincere love. Father, dear Lord, we are nothing without your love. We can do nothing without your love. Father, this morning, even as the word came, Heavenly Father, dear Lord, Father, I pray that we will put it in our hearts, dear Lord. We will live it. We will live by your word which is love. Father, I pray for every soul, everyone who have received the message. Father, dear Lord, even those who may think that they are not loved, who do not feel loved this morning, Father, let me remind you that God loves you. He loves you with an everlasting love. So I pray that you will get up from where you are and experience the love that God has for you. And Father, we pray of this in no other name but the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you. May your hearts be blessed this morning.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all systems and all the ways of man, above all kingdoms.
greatest love. For God so loved that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Today we want to celebrate this love. The Word of God says that even though Christ was equal with God, he humbled himself. He became obedient even to the death of the cross. So the reason why we're here today is the fact that Christ came, Christ died, Christ was buried, Christ was resurrected, and Christ is in heaven interceding on our behalf. So let us celebrate his death. Let us celebrate our freedom. We sang the song this morning, I am no longer a slave to fear. But I always say, I am no longer a slave to sin. I'm no longer a slave to Satan. I am no longer a slave to the power of Satan. Let us enjoy the love, the gift, the greatest gift, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. The Word of God says, as often as you do it, you're doing it, showing your gratitude to God. So let us go through the ritual now. It says, O God of grace and mercy, we thank you that you have loved us and you have provided for our redemption. We thank you for your Son who died to save us, and for your Spirit who invites us to draw near. Guide us now as we commemorate the suffering of our Lord. Help us to remember the cost of our salvation. Help us to commune with you and with each other. And so we ask you to consecrate the bread and wine which are here prepared, that as we partake of them, we may receive the spiritual benefits of Christ's broken body and shed blood. In his name we pray. Amen. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Take and eat this, remembering that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith. With thanksgiving, you may eat the wafer. Blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve your soul and body of everlasting life. Drink this, remembering that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. You may drink. May the God of peace, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together quickly. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Forgive us
our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And
lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us
from evil.
For
thine is the kingdom,
the power,
and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Shall we stand? I wish to say thank you to our speaker this morning. There was a lot of love going around in the church from very early in the morning. I am hoping that it will continue throughout the year. Thank you, Sister Gail, for the message that you would have presented. Thank you, Brother Rondell and Sister Kerry, for reading the scripture lesson, all the musicians and all the persons involved, Pastor, everyone. We thank you this morning for ministering. And there's only one thing that I would like to say. I cannot add or subtract to the message this morning, but if you love God, do His commandments. That's the only thing that I would add to that. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of His countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
As you exit, please leave your offerings in the basket. Thank you very much.
All personnel who have been in today's